हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू लेक्चर नंबर 4 फॉर चैप्टर नंबर 8 अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स एंड एग्जॉस्ट इमिशंस। सो इन प्रीवियस 3 लेक्चर्स वी डिस्कस द अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स एंड देयर रिक्वायरमेंट्स एज वेल एज सुटेबिलिटी ऑफ द अल्टरनेटिव फ्यूल्स फॉर एसआई इंजिन एज वेल एज फॉर सीएनजी। इन लास्ट लेक्चर, थर्ड लेक्चर, वी ऑल्सो डिस्कस द इमिशंस और पोल्यूटेंट्स emitted from SI engine and CI engine. Which are the different pollutants from SI engine and now in today's lecture we are going to study the different controlling methods for the SI engine emission as well as the for CI engine emissions. Getting? We have to discuss
so as
the
we
different
know that
controlling technologies
the, what are the
for SI engine
emissions
and CI engine, which is emitted from the engine. To control these emissions, first we have to understand the emissions, these pollutants which come from first, that is the particulates, which are the solid particles of carbon soot and fuel additives that blow out of the tailpipe. It is a visible one, it is a suspended in atmosphere. These particulates are suspended in atmosphere and it is a visible one. You can find this particulate at the exhaust pipe, at the tailpipe. Then engine crankcase blowby, which is caused by the heating of the fuel oil and unburned fuel vapors that blow past the engine rings, which blow past the piston rings as well as the piston, and in the crankcase is going to be cause the hydrocarbon emissions. Then fuel vapors, that is evaporative loss. So different chemicals that enter the atmosphere as a fuel evaporates. So as we know that fuel is evaporated through the fuel tank and the carburetor and it causes the evaporative loss. Then engine exhaust gas, that is a very harmful chemical that are produced inside the combustion chamber and are blow out at the tailpipe. Means due to the combustion, the exhaust, this emissions which include the hydrocarbon emission, which include the carbon monoxide emission, which include the oxides of nitrogen emissions, particulate matter, soot particles, smoke, you can observe that is at the tailpipe, at the exhaust. So here it is shown which are the that different exhaust pollutants that is to be observed at the tailpipe. So can you observe at the tailpipe all the emissions, almost all the pollutants are observed at the tailpipe, namely HC, CO, solid particles, oxides of nitrogen. Getting from the fuel tank, you can observe the fuel vapors which causes the HC emission. And the crankcase, you can found the again HC emissions due to the unburnt fuel oil. Correct, due to unburnt fuel oil, you can observe such hydrocarbon. So automotive manufacturers are agree the best way to lower the exhaust emission is to burn all the fuel entering the combustion chamber. So one of the way to reduce the emission is to burn the complete fuel, means completion of the air fuel mixture inside the combustion chamber is very much important. Complete combustion of air fuel mixture inside the combustion chamber is very much important to lower the exhaust emissions. Meaning, so the modern engine have introduced the several modifications to ensure all fuel entering the combustion chamber is burned. It will going to ensure that whatever the air fuel mixture inside the combustion chamber is going to be burned completely. So some modifications are here. Lower compression ratio. So by lowering compression ratio, vehicle can burn unleaded fuel. The use of unleaded fuel allows for catalytic converter that help to reduce the HC and CO emissions. Lower compression ratio also lower combustion temperature, which will reduce the NOx emission. As we know that NOx emission is going to be occur when the combustion temperature is high and when the sufficient amount of oxygen is available. So once the lower compression ratio, that will ensures the lower combustion temperature. and in that way it reduces the NOx emission. Then smaller combustion chambers allows the more heat to remain inside the combustion chamber, that can help in burning of fuel. Means compact combustion chambers is again very much useful. Then reduce the quench areas, reduce the cooling areas. So cooling areas or quench areas, the areas between the piston and the cylinder head is the quench area. If these areas is closed, fuel will not burn. Meaning if you are going to avoid these quench areas, then what happens, the fuel will not burn. If you are going to close these areas, fuel will not burn completely, increasing HCI and CO emissions. Meaning, so modern engines are designed to reduce the high quench areas. So we have to reduce these quench areas, we have to avoid such a cooling areas. Then decrease the wall overlap. So what is wall overlap? So wall overlap is period during which the exhaust and inlet wall remains open at the same time. Both walls are remain at the same time. If we are going to decrease this wall overlap is used, then decrease in exhaust emissions. So wall overlap should be minimum. A larger wall overlap increases the power. It increases the power, but it dilutes the incoming air fuel mixture. Getting it diluting the incoming air fuel mixture and requires the rich air fuel mixture at lower engine speed. Therefore, increasing HCI and CO emissions. So decrease in wall overlap is. So there are several different ways to control the emission in the modern vehicles. So the new technology is day by day it is arriving, and by using these new technologies one can control the emission in the. So first we have discussed the thermal react. That is also the one method to control the emission, that is thermal reactor. So if you see the figure, in the thermal reactor the engine, here engine is there, so engine exhaust is connected with the thermal reactor. If you see here, it is connected with the thermal reactor. So this thermal reactor is a chamber in the exhaust system. So if you see, engine exhaust is connected with the thermal reactor. So this thermal reactor is a chamber in the exhaust system designed to provide sufficient sufficient residence time is available. It provides the sufficient time to allow the appreciable homogeneous oxidation of HCI and CO at the engine exhaust. Getting, so as we know that in the engine exhaust HCI and CO emissions is there, so these HCI and CO emissions are to be come in this thermal reactor, in this chamber, and here the sufficient time is to be provided. Getting, sufficient time is provided for oxidation of these HCI and CO emissions. Getting, so in order to improve the CO conversion efficiency, the exhaust temperature is increased by spark retardant. Getting, exhaust temperature is increased by spark retard so that the conversion efficiency of CO will be increases. Getting, so in this way the engine exhaust is connected with thermal reactor. Getting, it is connected with thermal reactor, to and here the thermal reactor provides the sufficient residence time for the HCI and CO oxidations. Getting, so exhaust manifold which allow a greater residence time for burning of HCI and CO with oxygen in the pumped air. So this cylinder secondary air pump provides the oxygen. Secondary air pump provides the oxygen, means oxygen is pumped from the air in this chamber. Getting, so cylindrical reactor with tangential entry of the exhaust manifold is attached to the engine. It is attached to the engine. So secondary air pump injects fresh air. The secondary air pump injects the fresh air into the reactor to keep the flame constantly burning, to keep the flame constantly burning, and thereby assuring the complete combustion. This reduces the hydrocarbon and carbon monoxides. So about 10 to 15% of exhaust gas is recirculated to the air cleaner via intercooler. Correct, via intercooler. And this reduces the temperature of the combustion gases and provides the control of NOx. Getting so it not only reduces the HC and CO emissions, as well as by reducing the temperature is also reduces the NOx emission. So this packing system also includes the enriched and stage carburetor temperature controls. Getting so in this way, so this thermal reactor is going to use to reduce the HC CO emissions, as well as by reducing the temperature it also reduces the NOx emissions. So this thermal reactor is a chamber connected to the exhaust pipe. It provides sufficient time to allow appreciable homogeneous oxidation of HCN CO. Secondary air is supplied in the thermal reactor, which promotes rapid mixing of same with the exhaust gases and allows the mixture to remain inside for sufficient time. The high temperature and oxygen oxidizes HCN CO emission. The engine exhaust is connected to reactor where secondary is supplied. Therefore, HCCO let out from engine burn completely here. About 10-15% of exhaust gases is passed through the intercooler and is recirculated to the engine. So, in that way, the temperature of the exhaust gases is reduces and it also help to reduce the oxides of nitrogen. Then next, that is a positive crankcase ventilation, PCV. It is also known as a PCV ventilation system. So again, the basic principle of crankcase blow by control system is recirculation of vapors. It is nothing but a recirculation of vapors back to the inlet manifold. Getting it is a recirculation of the vapors. So whatever the vapors from the engine combustion chamber that leak out past the piston and piston rings into the crankcase, and whatever these vapors are there, these vapors are recirculated these vapors back into the inlet manifold. Getting back to the inlet manifold. So here again that will be recirculated through this PCV valve into the inlet manifold. Getting so the gases escaping past the piston and entering into the crankcase. Gases past the piston, here piston and piston rings are there. So gases from the combustion chamber which are going to be leaked through this piston and piston rings and entering into the crankcase are returned back into the inlet manifold and then to the engine during. So during the compression, the HC enters the crankcase due to the pressure difference between the engine cylinder and the crankcase. Correct. Due to the pressure difference between the engine cylinder and crankcase. So there is in crankcase small vacuum is there, and in the engine cylinder high pressure is there. And the HC from crankcase is taken back into the intake manifold during the expansion stroke. Getting and backside of the piston compresses the crankcase gases. Getting so during the expansion stroke, the piston again compresses these fuel vapors which are entered into the crankcase, which are leaked from this piston and piston ring and come into this crankcase. They are again supplied to the or recirculated to the inlet manifold. Getting so it uses the engine vacuum to draw blow by gases into the intake manifold for reburning in the combustion chamber. So when piston moves in a compression stroke, a little but vacuum is to be generated in crankcase, and this engine vacuum is used to draw blow by gases means whatever the air fuel mixture or vapors are enter or leaks from the piston and piston rings into the crankcase. So they are again recirculated to the intake manifold for reburning of the combustion chamber. So again, the vacuum or electronic controlled mounted on the valve. So this vacuum PC valve, it may be a mechanical or electronic control. So in earlier years, automotive manufacturer uses the road drop tubes to remove the crankcase blow by gases. The uses of road drift tube allowed for blow-by gases containing HCCO particulates sulfur, small amount of water to be entered in the atmosphere. At idle, when there is a high engine vacuum, the PC valve is pulled open to remove blow-by gases from inside the engine. So if you see here how the gases or these fuel vapors are to be leaked behind the piston or past the pistons. So crevices, that is known as the crevices. So crevices in the combustion chamber are narrow regions into which the fuel, so these areas, crevices in the combustion chamber are narrow regions into which air fuel mixture can flow, but the flame cannot propagate, flame cannot proceed through these areas due to their high surface to volume ratio. Because when flame propagates through this region, the flame is going to die, flame is going to die in this area, because these areas are the quench area, these areas are the cooling area, so when flame comes here, it will be die. So because the surface to volume ratio is causing the flame to end here only. So the largest crevices between cylinder wall and the piston top land and second land. So if you see here, crevices, this is a land, top land, second land, likewise such a crevices area is available in between the piston and the cylinder wall. So also there are other crevices present, for example the gasket between the cylinder head and the block ring. So there also such areas are available, such cooling areas are available, where the air fuel mixture or air fuel vapors are to be trapped in these areas and they are not taken part into the combustion, and because of that it results in incomplete combustion, and this air fuel mixture may enters into the crankcase, they are leaked into the crankcase, so there are different areas there also around intake and exhaust valve seats. Intake and exhaust valve seat also such areas are available. Also the threads around the spark plug, as we know that to tap the spark plug into the cylinder head, the threads are provided on the spark plug. So these threads around the spark plug and the space around the central electrode and the spark plug, these areas also known as the crevices area. This is quenching area. So at a part throttle, when vacuum is lower, the spring inside the PCV valve forces. So this PCV valve is a spring operated. So it will be operate on the vacuum, whether vacuum is less or more, accordingly it will going to be open. So when engine vacuum is high, PCV valve plunger is nearly closed. So when engine vacuum is low, plunger opens, allowing exhaust gases into the engine. So again it is going to recirculate the whatever the fuel vapors in the crankcase into the again engine cylinder. So this system gives two benefits. Atmospheric pollution by blow by becomes negligible, because these HC vapors or this air fuel mixture vapors are again take part into the combustion, and by that way it reduces the pollution. Second, with improved crankcase ventilation, formation of oil sludge and oil contamination is reduced. Whatever these air fuel gases are there, they are going to be ventilated, they are to be recirculated, and because of that it avoids the contamination of oil or sludging of oil. There are the two benefits of this positive crankcase. So next we will discuss the evaporative emission control system. We discuss the evaporative emission control system. So in earlier days it is known as the ELCD, evaporative loss control device. In earlier days it is known as the evaporative loss control device. So here figure is shown, which shows the intake manifold, charcoal canister, roll over wall, fuel tank, and this is the unvented fuel cap. Getting. So the purpose of this device, the purpose of this device is to collect all evaporative emissions. The purpose of this device is to collect all evaporative emissions. All evaporative emissions, that is the vapors, and recirculating them at proper time. Getting. So the purpose is solely to arrest the fuel vapors and release this arrested fuel vapors back into the engine cylinder. So this device is to be shown in this figure. It consists of the charcoal canister that is known as the absorbent chamber. Then purge control valve, or here rollover valve is there also. It having the pressure balancing valve is there, which is not shown in the figure. Fuel tank, that is obvious. Getting. So the fuel tank and the carburetor. The fuel tank and the carburetor, which can hold the hydrocarbon vapors. Getting. Where the hydrocarbon vapors are there, where the fuel vapors are there. So this absorbent chamber, this charcoal canister, which can hold the hydrocarbon vapors. Getting. The charcoal canister is absorbent chamber which is going to arrest the fuel vapors before escaping the atmosphere. Getting. What are the fuel vapors which are going to be escaping from the atmosphere? Instead of that, these fuel vapors are here, it is to be held in the charcoal canister through this rollover valve. Getting. Also same time, whatever the fuel vapors in the carburetor, in the float chamber, that also holds into this canister. Getting. So the fuel tank and the carburetor float, which are main sources. As we know that the fuel tank and the carburetor, which are main sources of HC emission in the form of fuel vapor, are directly connected with this charcoal canister. And when the engine is turned off, that is under hot soak condition, this causes the petrol to boil from the carburetor and float, carburetor float, and large amount of petrol vapor comes out. So all these vapors are during stopping or running of the engine are absorbed or are held in this charcoal canister, in this absorbent chamber. Getting. So in this way, evaporation of this fuel vapors is to be reduces. Getting. In this way, evaporation loss is to be controlled by such a devices. Getting. That is known as the ELCD device. So in this case also, it is shown on the one figure. That is, a electronic control is there, purge valve is there, fuel tank, charcoal canister, again it is to be supplied to the engine. So EVAP system prevents hydrocarbon in the form of fuel vapors, correct, from entering the atmosphere even when vehicle is not running. This device aims at controlling all evaporative emissions by capturing air or fuel vapors and recirculating them at appropriate time. An EVAP system is considered a closed system. EVAP system is a closed system. Fuel vapors are stored in charcoal canister. Fuel vapors are arrested or held in charcoal canister, which is an absorbent chamber, when the engine is off. When the engine is started, vacuum pulls the fuel vapors into the engine for burning. So EVAP system different from per emission vehicle because no fuel or vapor is vented to the atmosphere. So in this case, a rollover valve is used to prevent the fuel spillage or the leakage or wastage of the fuel in case of the rollover. It avoids the wastage of fuel. Then liquid vapor separator is sometimes used. Liquid vapor separator is sometimes used to prevent the liquid fuel from entering the charcoal canister. The charcoal canister is used to store fuel vapor when the engine is not operating. So most modern vehicles electrically control the EVAP system to ensure a clean burning engine. So EVAP system uses purge lines to connect the fuel tank to the charcoal canister and the intake manifold. Getting? So this EVAP system is use the purge lines to connect the fuel tank to the charcoal canister and the intake manifold. So in this way, the evaporative this control system is also used in the vehicles to reduce the evaporative loss. That is nothing but HC emissions. Getting? Now, next we will do the exhaust gas recirculation. So again, it is very important regarding the exam point of view. Exhaust gas recirculation or EGR system has two important jobs. One, the recirculation system is used to burn unburned gases, HC and CO emissions, that is the HC and CO pollutants. By recirculation of unburned gases, lower emission can be achieved. Getting? So recirculation system is used to burn these HC and CO, that is the gases. Getting? By recirculation again into the engine cylinder. Second, by lowering the combustion chamber temperature. So by lowering the combustion chamber temperature, it reduces the NOx emission. As we know that NOx emission is occur when the combustion temperature is higher and oxygen is available. In that case, NOx emission is to be higher. So in this case, EGR system avoids the NOx emission by lowering the combustion temperature. So exhaust gas recirculation refers to introduction of exhaust gas into the engine along with fresh air fuel mixture or inlet air. Getting? So EGR refers to introduction of exhaust gas into the engine. Getting? So exhaust gases are again recirculated. Getting? They are again take part into the combustion into the engine cylinder with the fresh air fuel mixture or inlet air, maybe that is depend upon the SI engine or CI engine. Therefore, there are two types of EGR, namely internal and external EGR. Internal EGR is achieved by increasing the wall overlap. Getting? If we are going to increase the wall overlap, again what happens, the exhaust gases which are going to be escapes from the exhaust wall, that may remain inside the engine cylinder because poor scavenging is there in that case by increasing the wall overlap, which results in the poor scavenging of the cylinder, which increases the residual gases contained in the engine cylinder, and by that way it going to dilute the fresh air fuel mixture or air. Getting? So this is known as the internal EGR. External EGR is achieved by introduction of exhaust gases from the exhaust system into the intake system, that is known as external EGR. Getting? So the heat capacity of the exhaust gas is higher than the air as it contains significant amount of CO2 and water vapors. So dilution of fresh intake charge by EGR combined with the exhaust residual gases left in the engine cylinder from previous cycle decreases the combustion temperature. Getting? It decreases the combustion temperature. So burn gases further reduce due to the lower combustion rates, resulting with addition of exhaust gas into the intake charge. So use of EGR also reduces mass fraction of O2. Getting? It reduces the mass fraction of O2, means less O2 is there in that case if we recirculated this exhaust gases. Getting? Because the exhaust gases replace the part of the air, and by that way it reduces the mass of the oxygen. Getting? It reduces the mass fraction of this oxygen as exhaust gases are to be replace the air, replace some part of the air. So all these factors cause the reduction in NO formation. Getting? All these reduction in NO formation. So EGR is defined as mass percentage of total intake flow. EGR is defined as mass percentage of total intake flow. That is nothing but a, so here the figure is to be shown, a simple figure is there. So if you see the figure, engine cylinder, these circles shows the engine cylinder. Here the intake system is there, here the exhaust system is there. This is the exhaust manifold, intake manifolds or intake system. So here it shows the exhaust gas recirculation system. So this is a typical layout of exhaust gas recirculation system for a carburetor or single point injection system. So a small fraction of exhaust gases, here a small fraction of exhaust gases directly from an exhaust system or exhaust tapping, a small fraction of this exhaust gases are directly fed, you see here, through this pipe is directly fed to the intake system. They are to be fed to the intake system via an EGR control valve. Getting a small fraction of exhaust gases are fed to the intake system via this EGR controlled valve. Getting so to increase the reduction in NOx, getting to increase the reduction in NOx, recirculated exhaust gas may be cooled. Getting this recirculated gas may be cooled. So function of EGR valve is, so function of this EGR valve is to meter or to control the exhaust gas depending on the engine operating conditions. Getting it will control or meter the exhaust gas depending on the engine operating conditions. Getting so the intake manifold pressure may be used to control the EGR rate. Getting so this EGR valve is to be operated on the intake manifold pressure. Getting so that is the engine operating conditions. So engine operating conditions is going to control or meter the EGR valve, and that by that way EGR valve is going to meter or control the exhaust gases. Getting it going to meter the exhaust gases to be enter into the intake manifold. Getting so vacuum control the EGR valves have, so this EGR valve is a vacuum control. Vacuum control means that is the engine intake manifold pressure, that will nothing but a vacuum. This EGR valve is to be operated on this vacuum. So the intake manifold pressure may be used to control the EGR rate. So vacuum control EGR valve have spring loaded diaphragm. So it is a, here spring is shown, this is a diaphragm, spring loaded diaphragm with chamber above diaphragm. Chamber above diaphragm is connected to the vacuum port. It is connected to the vacuum port through the throttle body. Correct, through the throttle body. So when there is no vacuum, when there is no vacuum in this intake manifold system, what happens for such as when engine is idling? When engine is idling, the vacuum is less. So the spring pushes the diaphragm down. This spring pushes the diaphragm down, closing the passage of the trapped exhaust gas and preventing its recirculation. Getting so it will push this diaphragm, spring will going to push this diaphragm, and thereby it avoids the entry of these exhaust gases into the intake manifold during the idling condition when pressure is less. Getting so when there is no vacuum is there. So as throttle is open, so as this throttle is open and it moves past the vacuum port, the intake manifold vacuum, so this here vacuum is generated and this vacuum is communication with the EGR valve, and again in the EGR valve spring is going to pull the diaphragm and thereby it opens the valve. Now as throttle is open, it moves past the vacuum port and in intake manifold vacuum is communicated through the port to the EGR valve. It lifts the diaphragm, getting it lifts the diaphragm and opens the passage and exhaust gases into the intake manifold, and thereby the exhaust gases are come into the intake manifold and they are to be enter into the engine cylinder. They are mixed with the entering air fuel mixture or inlet. Getting so small fraction of exhaust gases taken directly from an exhaust tapping is fed into the intake manifold via EGR control valve. So to increase the reduction in NOx, recirculated exhaust gases may be cooled. Function of EGR valve is to meter the exhaust gas depending on the engine operating conditions. The intake manifold pressure may be used to control the EGR rate. So vacuum controlled EGR valve have a spring loaded diaphragm with chamber above the diaphragm connected to vacuum port in the throttle body. When there is no vacuum, such as when in engine is idling, the spring pushes the diaphragm down, closing the passage of the trapped exhaust gases and preventing its recirculation. So as throttle is open, it moves past the vacuum port and the intake manifold vacuum is communicated through the port to the EGR valve. It lifts the diaphragm and opens the passage of exhaust gas to the intake manifold. So a ported vacuum switch or thermal vacuum switch is installed between the intake manifold and EGR valve. It prevents EGR until a set engine coolant temperature is reached. So some system also employs the exhaust back pressure controlled EGR. Getting, so it uses the exhaust back pressure to operate the EGR valve. So at light loads, engine exhaust pressure is low and the back pressure sensor keeps EGR valve closed. When engine load or speed is increased, back pressure increases, make the EGR valve to open. Getting. So however, in the modern engines, EGR rate is controlled by engine management microprocessor. Getting. So electronically controlled microprocessors are to be again used in the